studying and reading God's Word. Let me just give you a couple quotes here very quickly and we'll dive off in. But Martin Luther said this, "I study my Bible like I gather apples. First I shake the whole tree that the ripest may fall. Then I shake each limb. When I have shaken each limb, I shake each branch and every twig. Then I look under every leaf. I search the Bible as a whole, like shaking the whole tree. Then I shake every limb, book after book, and then I shake every branch, giving attention to the chapters. Then I shake every twig, or a careful study of every word, every paragraph, every sentence, and their meaning." I say, man, I get in there and I get after it, is what he's saying. Mark Twain said, "Most people are bothered by those passages of Scripture they do not understand, but the passages that bother me are those that I do understand." See, we're to read and study God's Word. It's the final authority. We're to grow in the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's why we want to get in God's Word. It can bring joy, it can bring encouragement, it can bring challenge, it can change your lives and making the dry bones live. George Mueller, who established many orphanages in England, said this, "I believe that the one chief reason that I have been kept in a happy, useful service is that I have been a lover of the Holy Scriptures. It's been my habit to read through the Bible four times a year." He said four times a year. "In a prayerful spirit to apply it to my heart and practice what I find there. And I've been, for 69 years, a happy man. Happy, happy, happy. Long before Phil Robertson." And so tonight we want to go to a parable, Luke verses 25 through 37. So let's read these verses here. It says, "Just then an expert in the law stood up to test him, saying, 'Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?' 'What is written in the law?' he asked him. 'How do you read it?' He answered, 'Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself.' 'You've answered him correctly,' he told him. 'Do this and you will live.' But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, 'Who is my neighbor?' Jesus took up the question and said, 'A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into his hands a robber, stripped him and beat him dead and leaving him half dead. And a priest happened to be going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. And in the same way, a Levite, when he arrived at the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan on his journey came up to him. When he saw the man, he had compassion. And he went over to him and bandaged his wounds and pouring on olive oil and wine. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii. Okay, a denarii was equal to 1 day's wage. Okay. Gave them to the innkeeper and said, 'Take care of him. And when I come back, I'll reimburse you for whatever extra you spend.' Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? The one who showed mercy to him." Then Jesus told him, "Go and do the same," or "go and do likewise." And so we want to break down this text. Kind of want to show you, hey, this is what I've been teaching you. Now let's break it down. Okay? So the first thing that we've had here is observation, right? Okay, what does the text mean? Okay, let's do some observation here. We got an expert in the law, right? Okay, we got an expert in the law, and he comes to what? To test Jesus. Okay. He asks a question. And I'm just going to simplify. What must I do to inherit eternal life? Okay. He asked him that question. Not eternal life, but eternal life. Okay. And then Jesus, what does? Jesus asked him what? 2 questions. He asked him 2 questions. What else do you see there? You observe. What does the text say? What do you see there? What's in the crime scene? You speak up. Go ahead.
With his question, it assumes feelings that he thinks he can do something to have eternal life.
Okay. He thinks you can earn. Thinks you can earn eternal life. Okay. Can earn it. Okay. What else? What else?
Jesus said, do this and you will live, knowing that we can't do that.
Okay. So he's saying you must do, you know, you must do this. Okay. You must do this. What else? Okay, tells him what to do. Jesus tells him what to do. Okay. Okay. What is a neighbor? Okay, neighbor. Y'all keep going because I won't get them all down. Do what now?
To justify his wrong.
To justify his wrong. Right, right. Exactly.
He knows the law, but he doesn't practice it.
Yeah, he knows it, but doesn't practice it. Jesus quotes two Old Testament verses here. Okay. He quotes two Old Testament verses, which would have been Leviticus 19:18 and Deuteronomy 6:5. Okay. What else do you see? What's happening in the story?
Throughout the entire story?
What happens in the parable?
The least likely people that pass by.
Okay, the least likely people, the least likely one comes and helps. Okay, the religious people went on the other side of the road. What happened to the man?
He's attacked.
He's attacked. He's left for dead. There's no sheriff there to help him out. Right? What else?
The two people that should have helped him
do. Right. What about the Samaritan man? What did he have? There we go. Okay, compassion. He pays the bill, basically. Okay.
Doctors his
wounds. Right. There we go. You're bringing out some cultural and racial barriers between Jews and Samaritans. There you go.
He stripped him of his clothes, so they didn't really know anything about the guy in the first place.
Right.
The Samaritan didn't have no idea.
Right. You would assume this traveler is Jewish because he's going from Jerusalem to Jericho.
Right.
Okay. So you're right. It's rocky terrain. To know that, you've got to get some historical background. It's rocky terrain, and there would be robbers hiding out, and so they would mug people along the way.
He was going down from Jerusalem.
Yes.
And Jerusalem is north.
Right.
Sorry, I forget the
yeah. But it was a rocky road down the way, so yes. Right, the Samaritan does because he also says, I'm going to put it on my MasterCard gold. Okay.
Well, except back then it was his word.
Right, it's his word. He said, all right, here's 2 denarii, here's 2 days' wages, and whatever else I'll pay for it. Okay. What else? Culturally, you need to understand a Jew would have not helped a Samaritan. What does Jesus then tell him to do? Go and do likewise. Okay, go and do. What else? Anything else you see? Who are the priests and the Levite? Who do they, well, Kelly's already brought that. They're religious people today. Okay?
Would the expert in the law could be a Pharisee or Sadducee?
Yeah, he could have been somewhat in that realm. Or a scribe, possibly. Yes. Okay? Now, when you hear the word Samaritan, what's the word you usually think?
Billy Graham, the Samaritan first.
Okay, there you go. And they do what?
They help people.
Okay, exactly. They help people out, which would be good deeds, right? But when you hear Samaritan, what's one word that comes to your mind?
Good.
There you go. Now, to a Jew, it was not good. Ugh! I hate them. They're half-breeds. We don't like them. They tick me off. They worship on another mountain. They worshiped on Mount Gerizim. They didn't like them. So Jesus chooses a Samaritan. As a model of what? Neighbor love. Exactly. Exactly what he does. Oh, yes, he didn't. They didn't. Exactly. Remember when Jesus came to the woman at the well? She was a Samaritan. She just couldn't imagine that, hey, that Jesus would talk to her. You know, and they get into that conversation, okay? You know, what is it? And so, see what I'm saying? That's what the text says. I mean, I don't have time to fill up this board, but we could fill up this board some more. You know what I'm saying? Dealing in the context, what's going on there. That's what's behind the text. We've got this. You've got two religious guys that walk up. These are the two religious leaders that come by. They don't have anything to do with this man. And then a Samaritan, of all people, a Samaritan comes and helps out this man. The Jews would have not liked that story. Okay? Exactly, exactly. Now let's move to interpretation. What does the text mean? What does the text mean? Okay? A parable will have one central lesson that Jesus is bringing out. Okay? A parable will have one central lesson that Jesus is bringing out. What is he bringing out with what we've been looking at on Sunday morning? God's heart beats for lost people. God cares for lost people. That's it. Are there multiple applications? Yes, we'll get to that in a minute. But there's one meaning here. Now, what's the meaning here? Exactly. There are no limits to those we should love. No limits. That would be one way to say it. There's no limits to who our neighbor is. Or you could say, hey, we're called to show compassion to anyone in need. Literally what we're to do, we're to show compassion to anyone in need. That's what he's bringing out. If interesting, what did you see? There's one word you saw between these two parables. It's compassion. Jesus, the Father had compassion on the Son coming back. This Samaritan has compassion on this man that has been left for dead, robbed, mugged, beaten, and he has compassion on him. And so we're to show compassion to those in need. Now, Augustine, in commenting on the Sermon on the Mount, he said this, when Jesus says to give to everyone who asks, he does not say to give everything that he or she asks for. Did you get that? There's a lot of people ask for a lot of things. But what do they really need? This man needed medical attention. He needed medical attention and some food. And that's what the man took care of. See, what happens is, folks, is many times our religion gets in way of demonstrating God's compassion to people. Sometimes doing church gets in the way of ministering to people. We get so busy doing stuff within the four walls that we forget that we're to minister to other people. And sometimes we can get very skeptical because we live in this world and people are trying to take many people for a ride. And it's very easy to become skeptical and hard. What Jesus is saying here, we need to have compassion. There's no limits on those that we should love. Saved or lost. Okay, sometimes we shoot our own wounded. Okay? And then sometimes we shoot those out in the world. So what are we showing? No love in and no love out. No compassion in, no compassion out. So we're to show compassion to people. Is that easy? No, this is not easy. So how do you deal with people? I just like, sometimes you just need to understand, I'm praying on the fly, Lord, is this dude really telling me the truth? And sometimes, like, I know this dude's shucking and jiving me. And then sometimes you can tell this person has really got a need and we need to meet it. Does that make sense? And sometimes I will try to err too much on the other side than being on the stingy side. But is that easy? Uh-uh. Because I don't know hearts. God does. But you and I don't. And so even my enemy, what Jesus is saying here, even my enemy is my neighbor. Ouch. Even my biggest competitor is my neighbor. Yeah. What would it profit to gain the whole world but lose your soul? And so that's what he's bringing out. Hey, we've got to show compassion to people. There's no limit to God's love. Even my enemy is my neighbor. That's what he's bringing out here. And so that's what the text means. And see, you can spend a little time in this, and you can, if you bring all this out and you've got a study Bible and you read through those notes, you'll bring out a lot of this. You're like, okay, I got the context. I got what's going on here. This is what the text is saying. Now, what does this text mean? And read it, and you'll be able to boil it down. There's no limit to God's love here. Parable has one meaning. Now, we're not talking revelation here, okay? So we can drive to the meaning here. Let's move to correlation. Correlation. What does the Bible say elsewhere about this topic? And so, just want to give you some comparison verses, okay? And let's read these. Leviticus 19, 15 through 18 says, "You must not act unjustly when deciding a case. Do not be partial to the poor or give preference to the rich. Judge your neighbor fairly. You must not go about spreading slander among your people. You must not jeopardize your neighbor's life. I am Yahweh. You must not harbor hatred against your brother. Rebuke your neighbor directly or you will not incur guilt because of him. Do not take revenge or bear a grudge against members of your community, but love your neighbor as yourself." That's where it comes from. I am Yahweh. Right there in Leviticus, which you didn't think anything was good in Leviticus. It's right there telling us we need to be in God's Word. Romans 13, 8 through 10 says, "Do not owe anyone anything except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments, do not commit adultery, do not murder, do not steal, do not covet. And whatever other commandment are all summed up by this, love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong." It up right there. You don't believe him? It's from Paul. Believe Jesus. He says, "I got to give you a new command. Love one another just as I have loved you. You must also love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples if you have" what? Love for one another. Three times, Jesus, bang, bang, bang. Love one another. Love one another. Love one another. Bang, bang. Well, I guess we're to love one another. Love one another. Galatians 5:14. "For the entire law is fulfilled in one statement." If you can't get it all, I'll get it down and I'll boil it down for you in one little statement. Love your neighbor as yourself. He says, I know you love yourself. And since you love yourself, show that same love to your neighbor. That's what he's saying. Now, can we earn our salvation by these texts? No. Now, this expert in the law, he was able to bring it. I love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. He knew how to quote them. He was in the Word. He knew the law. But can we be saved by those? No, it's more than adopting a code, a behavior. It's a spiritual relationship that affects every area of your life. So you get in there and you'll be able to find there's some other scriptures that'll correlate. If they do not, you can't find anything to correlate with what you're finding, you need to talk to some people. Because you may have found it, you may be coming up with what's not in the text. Does that make sense? But this text is very easy to find something that's going to say, love one another, love one another, love your neighbor, love your neighbor, love your neighbor. It's right there. And you use those verses, hey, this is what I'm to be doing. Jesus didn't say it one time, he said it many times. It's in God's Word several times. And so get in there and correlate. That's why you have cross references. You know, you've got treasury of scripture knowledge. Of literally, you can find other verses that will talk on the same topic. Now, again, not all verses that you go to will be a great correlation, okay? Because it's dealing with different contexts. So you have to be careful there. Application. Application. Now what? So what? What's going on here? Okay? What are you dealing with here? Okay? How does this apply to my life? Now let's boil this sucker down. I mean, we just don't stay high and pie in the sky. It's got to live in 2017. You got to bring it over. One of the questions is, who is my neighbor? Who's my neighbor? Is there, as we look at this, is there anything I need to change in my life? Is there a promise I need to claim? Is there something I need to pray? Who are you to show love and mercy to this week? Everybody. As we look at this, is maybe there a verse I need to memorize out of this? Is there a command? Is there a challenge? Is there a person I need to forgive? Is there someone I've offended? Is there a lesson to learn? Is there something that I'm running from? You got all those questions that you can ask. You got to ask of the text. And you ask them of yourself. What do I need to change? Well, what we may need to change is I need to work at showing love to all people. Or maybe this week, I just need to try to smile at people as I see them. Okay, instead of having an angry growl, let me just smile at them. And if I get eye contact, and maybe say, hey, what's up? Good to see you. Hi. You never know how God might use that to make a conversation. What do you see here as far as application?
Mm-hmm. He used two examples of a Levite and a priest.
Mm-hmm. There you go.
That ignored the dude.
Mm-hmm.
And then chose somebody that a scribe would not want to love as the one he should love. So it correlates to the scripture that, you know, what is it to love someone who loves you back?
Exactly. Exactly, exactly. And so, what's some personal application here?
Love everyone, no matter who they are.
Let me give you maybe a prayer. Lord, forgive me for judging people. Lord, forgive me of not helping people. What would application be? Another prayer. Lord, give me wisdom and discernment when dealing with people who need help. See, that's application, right? That's pretty much where we live. It's not like, ooh, you kind of hitting the rubber where the road. Yeah, that's exactly what Scripture. See, if the Scripture stays up there, it don't hit us where it lives. And then, hey, we can just live whatever stinking way we want to. And it doesn't change our life. See, the thing is, if you'll get in the Word, then the Word will get into you, and then it'll start changing your life, and then you'll start living it out, and you won't be living like some Baptists that don't give a rip about people going to die and going to hell. You'll realize, hey, I'm supposed to live for Jesus, and this is not something playing church, but it's about doing it and living it and acting it. That's what it's about. That's why I challenge you and me to get in the Word. Most of the time we don't get in the Word and we just skim over it and it doesn't change your life. And that's why we're dead cold and we walk out of the place and nothing happens and you pour out your stinking heart and preach God's Word and nobody has a tear for lost people.
Come on.
Now you ready to go home? That's why we have to be in the Word. That's why. Because if we don't know the Word, we can't live the Word. If you don't even know where it is in the Word, how are you going to live it? And if you don't spend time digesting it, you're not going to live it. And you won't confess sin for being judgmental. And you won't ask God to forgive you of your racism. And judging people for how they look and what color they have, where they live, what side of the tracks they live on, where they live, what they have in their pocket. It doesn't really matter because they were created in God's image. Which says, Jesus said, again, be honest with you, most of us would be the Levite and the priest. We just would. But that's not what side of the tracks we're to be on. So, what would a verse we might memorize out of here? Well, think about verse 27. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself. Not simple, but man, oh man, is that hard to live?
Amen.
Amen?
You put it to who the neighbor is.
I mean, yeah, there we go. Come on now.
Because the neighbor is anybody that you
want to call. Yeah. Now let me just apply this to you, husband and wife. You need to understand, that's your neighbor. That's your neighbor. The reason sometimes our marriages are suffering is we don't love our spouse like they're a neighbor. See, if you don't love your spouse as a neighbor, you definitely ain't going to marry anybody outside your house. You're not going to show them the love of God. See, it starts there and then should go out from there. Yeah, who is your neighbor? See, the Jews thought, You live in my neighborhood. You're my homie. You my neighbor. All you people live on the other side of tracks, you ain't my neighbor. You trash over here. Y'all are the goats. We the sheep over here. Exactly. I'm serious. That's how they thought. And before you pile on them and kick them out into the garbage dump, many times we think the same stinking way. You live on that side of the track, you stay over there. You live on that side of the bridge, you stay over there. That's what I'm saying. You river cats, you stay over here. Us country bumpkins, we stay over here. Or city slickers, I don't know what y'all call yourselves here. I hadn't figured that out yet, so. You know, I'm not sure. Are you dogs, wherever you live, you know. But you know what I'm saying? And they misinterpreted Scripture. Because they had it in the law. It's right there in Leviticus. And they missed it. Both.
Hard,
and did not want to do it.
Notice he was trying to justify himself.
Yeah. Can't justify your behavior.
Jesus was going to say the Samaritan was his neighbor.
Oh, no, no, no. Exactly. Your neighbor is.
He made it his enemy. Jesus made it his enemy.
If we fly to Australia today, that's my neighbor over there.
The one you probably think the least of is just the one you can tell us about.
Exactly.
So that cashier that you get mad at Walmart.
Exactly. That's your neighbor.
That's my neighbor.
That's why you should go through self-checkout. So if you got a problem with a checkout person, it's your fault. But again, you need to understand this. If you don't believe I'll do it, I will, and I have. You treat somebody like that in the public, bad in the store, I will come to your house.
Amen.
And you will go apologize to that
Amen.
Person.
Amen.
You say you don't believe me? I'll take you to my church. I'll take you to a family. Now, she went back and was repentant, but she acted like a horse's batoot to this lost girl that actually had come to our church. So you don't know who's standing there.
That's exactly
right. I was reminded of that recently. Luckily, I was like, I'm glad I treated that girl right because I just realized she's been to our church.
Doesn't
matter. So you don't know who you're seeing every day. But you do know, need to understand this. Somebody that you do see tomorrow will be your neighbor. So treat them that way. Say, hey, neighbor. They're going to say, what are you talking about? Just treat them that way.
I might be a little bold in saying this, but we kind of see this going on in the world today, but it kind of shows you that maybe the Samaritans and people who we would classify as not saved are getting more in this world than even believers are doing.
Oh, yeah.
The church, it says even in James that we're supposed to be taking care of the poor and the widows and everything else, but there's lost people that have their own things that they're doing morally right.
Yeah, they're trying to do good things.
We call ourselves Christians and ain't doing it, so we're talking the talk and walking the same.
Yeah, you're walking your talk. They have to match, and many times our walk and our talk doesn't match. And so the essence here is, really, to be honest with you, the essence of what he's bringing out is discipleship, which I believe is the ministry of the church,
yeah.
Is to love God, love people.
Amen.
And if you'll love God, love people, you know what? Then you'll reach them with the gospel, and then you'll disciple them and say, hey, this is the life. We're to love God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength, and we're to love people just like we loved you. We found you in the dump somewhere. You were in the gutter, and you met the Father, and your life hasn't been the same since. And you tell other people about that. So that's what we're to be about. And I chose this parable because I knew you would know it. And we a lot of us have heard this parable since we were little rugrats in Sunday school. And we know we're supposed to do this. But a lot of times we don't. Why? It's not popular. And it's not easy. It really isn't. It's scary. Yes, it's scary. And to be honest with you, we live in a griping, complaining, stinking world that everybody's complaining about something. I challenge you one day, I challenge you to fast from complaining. And that's going to be harder than you think. Because you turn on the TV, what are they complaining about? Something, somebody, this body, the president, this, that, who cares? What do? They complain. That's what the world does. Exactly. Because that's all we know. But you know what happens in the church? Same thing. We complain about this or that, or didn't like the preacher, he preached too long, he said this, hurt my feelings, and you went home and had fried preacher. With your fried chicken. People did today. Don't blame me? You crazy. Because it happens. You know, I've told churches, my last church, I'll tell you, because I know what happens. You eating breakfast with guys tomorrow and you trash your preacher? I pray your egg turn into gravel in your mouth. That's what I pray. And when you have fried, just go ahead and teach you this truth. I'm sure you're not doing this, and I'm not saying you are, okay? I'm just telling you like it is, because I have buddies in the ministry. But you need to know this truth. When you fry preacher before your kids and your grandkids, don't expect them to be in church when they grow up to be adults. Because they will learn to hate the man of God and they will learn to hate the church. That's why we're to love God, love people. None of us are perfect. We're all sinners saved by the grace of God. Praise God.
Amen.
He welcomed me, kissed me, embraced me, and put his robe on me, which I did not earn or deserve because I'm a chief of sinners. So we're to love God, love people. Let me just give it to you. Craig Blomberg, who's a professor, writes a lot of commentaries. He just gives this last illustration. We'll wrap it up like this, because I think you get the point. No sense in belaboring it. He says, basically, Jesus doesn't want us to go around and get a donkey and secure some oil and wine and look for every needy person and take them to the local innkeeper and give them 2 silver coins. And Craig says, hey, I'm not a man of mechanical ability. I'm not very good when it comes to fixing cars or anything. They were driving in Yellowstone Park, him and a friend, on a snow-packed road, and all of a sudden their car spun into a ditch. And they're like, what are we going to do? A man came with a truck, came along and pulled them out and pulled them back on the road. And he said, that was a picture of the Good Samaritan. They were semi-isolated. They were on a snow-packed, slippery road, didn't know how they were going to get out, didn't have cell phone service, and all of a sudden a Samaritan comes by full of compassion and shows them compassion and helps them out. What are we to do to show compassion on people? Do we mess up, blow it? Yes, we do. Let's just be honest. You know what we have to be careful of, and this is one last application. We have to be very careful that our heart does not become calloused to those in need. Because we see so many times people that are out there that are really not in need, that are taking people for a ride. You got panhandlers that make more money than some people that are making in their job. And I've seen that. I've been in Gulfport. I was the first church north of I-10. I had them all coming to me. I understand that. What we have to be very careful is sometimes our hearts can become so calloused that we don't see any more needs anymore. And we don't show any more love. And we don't show any more compassion. That's what we have to be careful of. So what are you saying? Sometimes we just need to be reminded. We need to be taken to this story that we've heard over and over and over and over and over again and just be reminded, hey, let's love people. Point them to Jesus. Care about them. Pray, is this a sincere need? And if it is, help meet it. And you never know how that might be what draws them to Christ. That's what he's caused us to do. Show compassion on people. Why? Thank Jesus, he showed compassion on us. Let's pray.